Do you think I need to go and paint that yellow BR, bruv?
Yo, party people, welcome to another episode of Arms House to Your Mum's House. I think this is episode 47. Big up my main man Themos, shout out Talal 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 Talal. This is just a little preamble into the episode. Unfortunately, me and Themos could not record an episode for this week. But I remembered that we had about 2-3 episodes we recorded last year. Right before, you know, like, and we kind of scrapped them and we started again. It's some weird thing. Anyway, so I've got like 2-3 in the chamber from back in when we first started doing this, like last year, I think beginning of last year. So technically this was episode 3 we recorded, but I'm going to play it for you now. Okay, and it's mainly just us chatting shit. I think there's a bit of pandemic talk because, like I said, this was a while ago. And we just listened to bare tunes, man. So I thought, hey, rather than have nothing, why not have a little satin satin? You know what I mean? Like I said, shout out my man Theme. Thank you guys for checking out the podcast and showing love. Leave a comment, subscribe, and all that good stuff. And consider joining the Patreon, where there's some exclusive stuff there for you to check out. It's only $3. What's that in pounds? It's like £2.50. You know what I mean? So get on that, man. That's the best way you can show some love. You get me? Anyway, Amber, out. Peace.
What's the Zugly?
Don't you remember Zugly's boy?
I don't remember Zugly.
He lost
Zugly.
His eyes. But Zugly, man. Me and Saul had there's bad boy toys from the early 90s.
Oh, right. All right, bro. I've started recording, man. What are you saying, geezer?
I'm all right, man. I've had a crazy, crazy week.
Oh, shit.
How are you?
I'm good, man. Yeah, I want to hear all about your week, man. But first, let me just introduce. This is Arms House to Your Mom's House podcast with me, Amber, and then my man here.
Themalicious.
Yeah, boy. This is episode 3, right?
Yeah, episode 3.
Third one. All right, cool. We recorded the first two before. Now we've kind of finalized the podcast. I think it's going to be on Audio Boom, and it's going to be available on every podcast app available. So check us out, man. And we also have a YouTube channel, so you'll be able to see us on the YouTube and hear us on the podcast apps. You know what I mean?
Is that made, the YouTube channel?
Not yet, but I will make it and I will upload
these. It's coming.
It's coming, yo. So yeah, Themos, usually here we cut up the podcast into little sections. We do a music section where we play music, just music that we like, music that's had an impact on us, and maybe just music we want to introduce people to.
Yeah, boy, definitely this week.
Yeah, and then we have a Themes rant. So he like goes off on something that's wound him up. You know what I mean? I have a little section called Amber's Favorite Conspiracy Theories. We'll see if we have enough time to get to that. And and they're just general bullshitting and rambling and chatting, man. So your theme was, what have you been up to this week, man?
Oh, man. I set up this painting and decorating company.
Yeah.
I've changed it to a limited company, limited business, set up my own limited business. Then I spoke to an accountant. He's like, what the fuck are you doing? You want to go back to being self-employed? Because until you earn like over 100 grand or you want to get employees, like, there's no point being limited. Yeah? Uh-huh. And it's going to cost you bare more dough on the taxing, on the accountant services. So I've done that with all companies house. Then I've gone back to being self-employed, and it's mad hard to change it back to being self-employed. I'm saving money for this wedding because my man's getting married in July. That's quite soon, man. I'm still getting ready for that shit. Dude. You know what I mean? Getting all that sorted. I had to send money. I got a funny story. Yeah? I had to send documents to Madrid, the British consulate in Madrid, because I need to get all my papers like translated. You need to get, when you're getting married, you need to get all this shit sorted out. Like,
it's can I just say, your missus lives in Madrid, yeah?
She lives in Spain.
In Spain,
she
yeah.
She works in all around. At the moment, she's working in Spain. She's from Venezuela. Cool. She lives in Malaga, south of Spain. Luckily, it's not Madrid. But as you know, Madrid and Barcelona, yeah, they got like a fierce rivalry. Yeah.
Big time.
It's madness. And you've got to get this thing called like a certificate of no impediment, which basically means you've proves you've never been married before. No one's going to kick off if you get married, blah, blah, blah. Mine's in English. You've got to get it translated into Spanish, yeah? So I have to send my English one to Spain. And they get it. It's from like the Ealing Council, my one, yeah? They get it. They translate it as long as it's all good, blah, blah, blah. And then they send me a Spanish one to an address in Spain, yeah? I hate Madrid, like with a passion, yeah? I don't like the place. It's really dry heat. It's mad expensive for Spain. It's not like Barcelona. I love Barcelona. Yeah.
Yo.
I used to spend hours on the beach in Barcelona just doing kick-ups just in case Ronaldinho came down the beach. Yeah. That was the only reason, yeah. Me and my bridge and Tim Lee. Big up Tim Lee, man. He still lives in Barcelona now. But I wrote it or put it all in. I had to send it. Recorded delivery. I put all at the embassy of Madrid on this calle, whatever the road was. I can't remember. And then on the other side, yeah, on big letters, I put Forza Barça, which means like Forza Barça. It means like Barca, come on, Barça.
Yeah.
And sent it to the fucking embassy of Madrid.
Oh, my God.
I sent a picture to the missus. She's going fucking mental. Like, you can't do that. They're going to be angry before they open the paper. I said, some fucking putas in Madrid, man. They can suck me, polla.
Damn.
So that cost me like 10 quid just to send that fucking shit over.
Jesus.
I started. I'm trying to do a drop shipping thing, yeah? Because I can't be doing, man, my man's 40 years old. Doing painting and decorating, breaking my neck, breaking my knees, doing the skirting, nowhere to sit, man. It's hard, man.
Yeah.
It is a young man's game, man. It's hard. So I started this drop shipping thing with this guy that I've met, rare. I had 500 items, yeah, that were available for sale, yeah. And today I was trying to be clever, trying to clear it up, clean up the web page. And there's two buttons, yeah, delete everything on this page or delete everything. I've clicked delete everything and pressed okay and poof, everything's gone, man. I'm fuming. I've lost all of that shit. I can't re-upload them because they think it's too bait. If you suddenly put like 500 items on, they come and check you out and that. So I'm like, oh man.
For God's sake, Stimos.
But I've nearly finished this big house that I'm working on. They paid me like, when I started the job, which was in like fucking end of March, see, I mean, obviously the money's gone, and I've been working on it for so long. I've only just maybe finishing it this Friday. Well, I have to because I've got a new job starting Monday. But I've got no money, man. Hence, I'm trying to do the drop shipping. Hence, I'm trying to do, you know, everything. Like, everything is costing, and all of a sudden, the kids need new trainers. The kids need this. They need to go to the half terms coming up. I'm like,
You see, that was Themos, the
most boring intro ever.
That's why I've orchestrated my life to have like the least amount of responsibilities. So I don't have to handle that shit, man.
Yeah.
Fuck that. But it's
because kids is kids. If you said to yourself, oh yeah, I need to get new shoes, new trainers, whatever, you can either go to like Primark and get some, or you can just say, no, fuck it. I'll just carry on with this pair of trainers. If your kids' trainers were getting holes in and shit, you're like,
No, of course, yeah. But your kids, they're not at the age yet where they're like, I need Nike Air Force Ones, yo.
They're not there yet. 8 years old. Today, or last Saturday, was the first time ever, pretty much my fault, to be honest, the first time ever where Alex is like, I need the air bubbles. He doesn't know what it is, but he knows it's Nike and he knows it's air bubbles. He's like, I need the air bubbles.
Oh.
So these air bubbles, like the minimum price, cheapest one I can find is like 40 quid, 37 quid. But because they're twins, that's 80 quid, man. It's like everything is double, man. I went to the corner shop just now, the normal corner shop, to buy three ice lollies. It's just under a tenner, bro. Like £8.90. I'm just thinking, what the fuck's going on? Oh, did you hear today? Some policewoman, detective, a detective. You know, I mean, not like a normal Bobby of the beat. She smashed Priti Patel yesterday in some meeting. This woman's on 40 grand a year. She works like 3 overtimes a week just to pay her mortgage, just to pay food. She's got £100 left over, yeah. She's done the service to the police for like 22 years. And, you know, because of the cost of living, people can't do anything. This woman's on 40 grand a year, been in a job for 20-something years, serving the public. They can't eat. She can't put blazer on her kid's back. She's only got one kid.
It's crazy.
Everything's crazy fucked. Times. The three ice lollies, bruv. It's like £8 something. I'm thinking,
hold on one sec. Let me close my door. I much prefer the role of uncle, you know what I mean? I got a lovely little niece. I just show up, you know what I mean, from time to time, buy ice cream, buy whatever.
Yeah, or just give it back to your sister. Like, there you go, Charlotte. I'm gone, man.
She's crying now.
Week. Yeah.
Exactly.
I won this competition in Nottingham, the UK takeover. It's quite a big thing in the UK.
I think I remember that. Yeah. I
went to Nottingham, did the ting, and...
was it a battle or was it a freestyle?
Yeah, it was rap battles at the time.
Sick.
And I've typed in everything I can imagine. Bruv, I won the jump off. Remember the jump off?
Yeah. I remember.
They sent me to the Prince's music something in fucking Earl's Court, like sold out Earl's Court. First time in my life I was rapping against some geezer. And I looked up and there's just bare screens. And it's me rapping and looking up at these screens. I was thinking, it really put me off. I was like, oh shit, what the fuck? This is going insane. Prince's.
You can't find any footage of this.
Prince's Trust. Nah.
I'll find some. I'm going
to
look it up.
Yeah, if you can find some, man, send it to me. I mean, I've tried a couple of times. Because this was like, I wrote down in my lyric books at the time. And all my lyric books are stashed in my mum and dad's basement. And they don't even chat to you anymore. So I need to like try and find if I can get to those. Yeah. But I wrote down, you know, the date, one jump off, rare, this day. Went to Earl's Court, did this thing that day.
Did you ever consider, I know we've chatted about this before, but I can't remember, it was a while ago, but did you ever consider like doing a don't flop thing when that was all happening? I remember we went to see your boy Tony D.
It was kind of
Tony
like,
D versus Illmaculate. We were in the crowd. You can see us in the crowd.
Illmaculate. Who was Ill? Oh, is he American geezer?
Yeah, American dude from, I can't remember where he's from.
I was in this though. Crew by then, called Ian Daniels, who was basically just that, like a crew of those guys from rap battling and Don't Flop.
Yeah.
There were so many of them doing it. I don't know why. I knew that if I enter, I'm not big enough on my interest here. I knew if I entered that with my personality and my bravado and my fake big balls and all this shit in my mouth, bruv, I would have, and my lyrical, like,
you would have killed it.
Syllable technician, I would have fucking blazed some of those guys in there, yeah?
Definitely.
And I don't know why. It was kind of just like, the mad stress, because for me, and this is for some of the battle fans as well, but for me, like a pause in the wrong place, that's a flop. You know what I mean? I had to be so fucking nailed on. I would like rehearse in the bedroom or whatever.
Mm.
And I just think maybe I wasn't up for that. But then we went on tours, like we went to Leeds and we went to, like, because we support each other. So like Tony was doing Leeds or whatever, or I think he battled in Manchester. I actually went with Chester P and Connie Conn, and that was in there first. I think it was Shotty Horror versus Tony. I can't remember, man, but we went to support each other all the time, rare. And we'd have ciphers. And in the ciphers, I remember thinking, holy shit, man. I'm blazing some of these motherfucking cunts, but I'm like literally wiping the floor with these motherfuckers. Because you know in a cypher which is filmed, when you're killing it, the camera kind of always goes back to you. If you go, like if you want to come in, it goes back to him. You're like, oh shit. And then on the YouTube comments, you're like, oh, the white boy kills it. You know, oh, the white boy is an absolute murderer. You know, all this kind of stuff. Joke shit. And I used to think, oh man, maybe I should go and do it again, man. But
No.
I was trying to get, as well, I was trying to make music.
Mm-hmm.
Not just battle rap anymore.
That was it. You were focusing more on that. You were releasing EPs and stuff, I remember.
Yeah, and that all flopped hard. So then I should have done Don't Flop.
Well, you never know how it would have come out. I mean, those things, like, I love battle rap, but like 80% of it is really shit, man. Especially the English one, man. A lot of it is proper whack.
So whack.
But that 15% at the top is really fucking good. You know what I mean?
And you didn't get anything for it. Like, Tony didn't get any that, you know what I mean?
You might get good money. Yeah.
He got sent to Canada once and that. And
I always looked at battle rap and how it originally started off. The battle was to promote your music. Ultimately, that's how I kind of saw it as being. So, yeah, you do the battle and take it for not much money. But you know that those, especially back then, they were getting mad views, man. So then they'd give you a little spot at the beginning of the battle to promote something.
Mm.
Or you could mention it during your battle or whatever, you know. So I always looked at, like, that's kind of, okay, you do it for cheap, but then you get to promote or sell some merch or something. Exactly. You know?
And Tony's of a generation of just, like, he's like a proper, like, black don't crack. He just never. He looks like, you know, the same as he did 20 years ago, 30 years ago. Me, I was doing battling, and I'm younger than Tony, but I was doing battling at, like, Carnaby Street, Deal Real Records.
Yeah.
Like Harry Love, Loki, Dot Brown, Reveal, and what's his name? Professor Green.
Yeah.
We're doing like battling on the street, Stigger the Dump. And yeah, there was that was something the else that was happening.
Stuff. Didn't you do then stuff at the Notting Hill Arts Club as well? Notting Hill Arts Club.
Yeah, that was just my own. I did a few gigs there.
Mm.
Mate, that was. I remember getting an envelope of cash because that worked with how many people you brought in. You got a percentage of the bar as the artist. Yes. And that was only me. There was no like warm up. There was no rare. So bam, did that.
Nice.
And that's when I used to think I was like semi-Jamaican and I was doing like, ring the alarm, another sound is dying. But they gave me an envelope at the end, man. And so I was like, yo, we got cash for rapping, motherfucker. It's sick.
Nice. Well, maybe we'll do some merch for the podcast, man. If we get some listeners.
Aunt's house, your mum's house. Tim West with the t-shirt.
Yo, fuck that guy.
We get worst, wackest graph writer of the week written on a t-shirt, and then I have to bowl down the street with it, man. You know what I mean?
Hey, yeah, that's another section. I don't think we're doing that this time, man. Wackest writer.
Your boy Zeal, he would love that if I was wearing that t-shirt, man. You know?
Yeah.
He went off at me that time on Instagram.
Oh my God.
Graph is dead. So I'm wearing the t-shirt to cheer him up. You know what I mean?
Yeah. We'll get him to print them, innit, at his t-shirt printing place. Yeah, man. All right, cool. Listen, let's go into our song selection now, yeah? Let's play a couple of tunes. We'll bring up the vibe a little bit. We'll, just introduce some people to some music or reintroduce them to the music or whatnot. Man. You've got a couple of classics in your one and one I haven't heard.
Have I got a classic? I definitely got one classic. And the one you haven't heard. Oh, man, it's killing me that tune at the moment, man.
Yeah. Should we start with that one?
Okay, yeah.
All right. Do you remember? Yeah, tell us what it's called, man.
It's called, well, I'm just trying to go to it. It's called Black. The artist is called Black the Sheriff, yeah? Black Sheriff, sorry. I think he's from Ghana.
Okay.
I think he's from Ghana. What I love about him is he does exactly what I would do if I could speak like bare different language. He raps in English and bam, in the same sentence is rapping in, I don't know what you would call it, Ghanaian? Ghanaian. He just changes it. And because they're quite like vocal and like music is and all these sounds as well as in like sudden like, it's like drill. It's kind of like drilly, trappy kind of music. Mm. But he's... because I find that quite boring, that kind of music, yeah? He's going in with all like these mad vocal bits, but what he says in this tune just resonated with me, man, hard.
All right, let's check it out, man.
Yeah. Kwaku killa don't lie when I say I did it.
Big stash, big cash, my way back till I find belief. Under 1 minute, till I can't believe. But I can't blame myself for this shit. A new man just was born for this shit. Of course I fucked up.
This bit.
Who never fuck up hands in the air?
No hands.
Still I can't believe.
Can't believe.
You know what I mean? I was young, what you expect for me? It is what it is. But I keep going, no.
It's
more like a rolling stone,
his
cause I have no stopping time. Can
not
nobody stop
him,
man? Oh, I keep going,
this,
no.
It was quite hard to pick a tune, but this is the newest tune he's released.
I'm gonna run my race.
But they are banging, bro. They're the kind of tunes you play in the gym and that. But for when on this tune, I saw a video on Insta, I think he was, and he's like standing indoors, but it's like raining on him. So he's doing a concert. They're pouring water on him and shit. He's like a tall, skinny dude, but he's so intense.
Yeah,
he's got so much power in his voice. You know what I mean?
Is he good live then? Is he like, he performs it like
the... sick. Like, I've never heard of him until like 2-3 weeks ago. Uh-huh. Of course I fucked up. Who never fucked up hands in the air?
Yeah.
No hands.
No hands.
You know, whoa, leave it at this guy. You know what I mean? But the other tunes he's done, he does more kind of wicked, wicked kind of vocals. But you can tell on that he's got his mad own technique and style. I think he's only 21 years old. Big up Black Sheriff, man.
You can see he's definitely like got a mature voice for a 21-year-old, man.
He's
damn
intense as well, man. Intense.
No, that's dope.
And I love the tune. The tune's called, what is it called? Kwaku the Traveler.
Traveler.
Yo, man, these are sick. He's a
Black
sick
Sheriff.
Guy.
Yeah, I'm going to have to dig out some more from Black Sheriff. Yeah, man.
I was reading about him. They say that the tune that blew him up was called The Sermon.
The Sermon.
The Sermon Part 2. I just got him right here. Second Sermon.
Okay, cool.
And
yeah, I'll check
deep.
That out. Wicked, man. Yeah, sweet. Nice. Introducing us to new shit, man. I like that.
Yeah, I thought that would be a good little shout, man, because, you know, new shit coming out.
Yeah, I don't have any new songs to show today, man. Mine,
that's cool.
One of them is a classic 90s. The other two are from the 2010s. We'll start with this one. Kev Brown is one of my favorite hip-hop producers. He's from just outside Washington, D.C. He's like around that area. Don't know exactly where. I can't remember. But anyway, he had a tune called Always, which is one of my favorite tunes by him.
I'm writing this down, man.
Yeah, check it out. Let's play a little bit first. I love my like jazzy hip hop styles, you know. And Kev is the king of bass lines, and he raps. This is him rapping.
Yo, I've never been in a serious relationship. Probably because I can't relate to chicks. Nowadays I'm trapped off, doing tracks to blast off. Being lonely's a regular thing.
He produced it as well, right?
Yeah.
I'm up in the lab composing. Seems like every girl I've chosen, heart's frozen. And maybe I don't know how to pick, though. Seems like every chick I know's
out to get, though.
And I ain't got a lot of that. And now I'm front about it. You think I'm going to be hitting your wall for
doubt it.
Crazy. Reminds me of like acrobatic or something like that.
These bras know off the bat. If you ain't
at the beginning, I thought it was the same sample as a Souls of Mischief sample.
Then maybe you can receive something real instead of the fake stuff.
I've been looking for that
very beginning.
Waits like always.
This is 2010.
I think 2012.
Because this could be 90s as well. This could be like 98.
The heck is this? You know, I'm really trying not to.
Anyway, that's a Kev Brown track called Always. It's on his album, I think it's called Albany.
I'm gonna check it out. I haven't listened to any of his stuff before, man.
Yeah, he's good. And like the thing is, you know, there's always that debate, the best producer on the mic, the best producer who can make beats and also rap.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's getting up there with me. I mean, who are the contenders? There's obviously Pete Rock and
Diamond D.
Yeah, Diamond D is definitely up there. Pete Rock, though, you know, he didn't really write his own lyrics, man.
Yeah. He's the one who says, I'm the best producer on the mic. Isn't it on a Nas tune or on a... Well, Diamond D says that on a tune for sure,
Diamond
actually.
D says it a couple of times. Yeah, and he actually did a song with Kev Brown and who's the other guy? Oh, man, that's going to bug me. They did a song called Best Producer on the Mic. It samples a Bob James sample and Kev Brown made the beat. And it's got Diamond D, Kev Brown, and... another motherfucker, I can't remember his name.
What, another rapper stroke producer?
Yeah, exactly. Oh, man, who was it? I can't remember. But anyway, it's a great tune. No, it's not High Tech, but High Tech, I mean, he's not the greatest rapper, I guess.
No.
Who else? There's Jay Dilla, you know what I mean? I was never a massive fan of Jay Dilla's rapping. I mean, he's good and his songs are dope and I love Slum Village, you know?
Yeah.
But, like the other guys in Slum Village, they rinsed... Dilla out when it came to rapping, man. They were ill. Yeah. What were they called? Fucking Batin and T1 or something? Fuck, man.
I remember Pete anymore. Rock and CL Smooth, he says, who's the best producer on the mic? He says it in that as well, on that album there.
Yeah. I mean, definitely you've got to put Pete Rock in the equation, but, you know, just him not writing his own lyrics, you know, is you know.
Dre.
Again, he didn't write his own lyrics either, so... Mm. You know, for me, he doesn't really slip in there.
He doesn't get the ratings from the Amber.
I'd put fucking...
You didn't write your lyrics, bitch!
Yeah, I'd even put Jest in there, man. Jest makes some ill beats. He's made some ill beats. And,
Jest made a wicked beat for Triple Darkness, man.
Oh, yeah?
Fuck yeah. Me. Heartless Island.
I've heard it. I remember you sent it to me.
Fuck me. I was like, yo, and because Cyrus Malachi mentions, you know, I saved my best heat for Jess beats or something like that. And I was like, shit, is this Jess? And it is.
Jess has done some ill remixes for people and some ill album cuts of his. Like, yeah. So, you know, again, I put
Parky,
him in
the Michael Parkinson, the Michael rapper Parkinson. Producer. Come on, bruv.
No doubt.
Uncle
no
Parky.
Doubt. For sure. Yeah. But yeah, anyway, so Kev Brown, I put him in that category, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So let's move on to your next one, the classic one. Yeah, from a classic album. But it's not, you know, everyone's go-to pick from that album. So why did you choose this one? This is Fuji's song called Cowboys. It's an ill song.
It's an ill song.
And talking about Diamond D, he produced the title track, the score from the album. He produced it. Anyway, yeah, so...
Does continue. He feature on that as a rapper as well?
Nah, he doesn't rap.
Oh, man. I mean, this tune is just like... Well, for starters, I recently downloaded the original sample, the tune. You know the... Play the tune. I'll talk about it.
I'll play it.
I Only Have Eyes For You by the Flamingos, man.
Ah.
But Lauryn Hill kills this. Weekend kills this. But this bit.
You love the singing rap type things. You love that shit.
I don't remember, but the reason I chose this tune. You shot your bullet, but the bullet
is
I went to see the Fugees with my boy Rami. Rami El Bagami. My Egyptian brother from school, yeah. We went to the Fugees concert in Brixton in the 90s, man. Actually, I'm going to Google that right now to see when that was because, bruv, that was a dangerous. You're getting out of the car, his dad dropped us off, and we were like, yo, this is one of those dangerous kind. You know, we were talking about One Nation and stuff.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, similar vibes. It must have been Brixton Academy. It must have been.
This was like, yo, as soon as we got out, we were thinking, holy shit. Damn. I mean, he was from Egypt, you know what I mean? I was as white as could be. The food.
You were there in the front.
I'll tell you what happened. So I was in love with that album, bruv. Absolutely in
everyone
love with
was.
That album.
Everyone
the Fugees
was.
Archive concert 1996, yeah, at the Brixton Academy, yeah. So I was 15.
Damn.
And we were, this is like in Brixton, you know when Brixton used to be Brixton? This is Brixton in the 90s, bro.
Yeah, yeah.
We went
no
there.
Joke.
And that was, we used to sing that bit all the time, me, him, and another, and all that kind of shit. And I went in there. I was like praying as fuck because I'd recently been to an Onyx and Cypress Hill concert with a geezer who was an absolute pussy, oh yeah, and it was horrific. We were getting trampled on and stuff. He was like basically crying, trying to go home. I was loving it because I was thinking, this is what it's like. Yeah, yeah, we've got to accept it. This is what it's like. Yeah. We were getting dashed about. I mean, Onyx and Cypress Hill, bruv. It was ridiculous. It was so gangster. Jeez. And I was probably, when I was 15, I looked 10. And anyway, so this was the next one. I was a bit praying because I had a bit of experience. I was like, oh, shit. But I was going with Rami, and we were in there, and we used to always sing that bit, Ole. And another, so what is it? Something, grab your gun, boy. Ole. And just as the tune was coming on, I was in the concert, I didn't know the tune was coming on. This ultimate rude boy, like, hey, rude boy, like, bend over, yeah? I'm going to build a zoo on your back. I was what the fuck? And I did, like, looked at Rami. He's like, bro, you best just do it. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We and this geezer was with, like, his girl and everything. They were all, like, you know what I mean? They looked like such big men to me. They were just probably in their 20s, yeah?
Yeah.
So I'm, like, bending on.
Oh, my God.
Like, I'm in the showers at the jail, such. Bending over. And he's billing his zoo, yeah? I didn't really know much about weed and that. I was 15, you know what I mean? I knew about it. He's billing his zoo. And that tune came so on. Joke. I must have been down like this, and I'm he's building his zoo, and I'm like, holy, and his whole zoo flies off my back. Luckily, his missus was pissing herself, because I saw in his face when it first happened, he was like, yo, you know what I mean? He was about to crack me the fuck out. He had like all gold teeth and gold rings. I remember all this shit.
Yeah,
Perry Ellis. I remember he had a big Perry Ellis jacket from back in the day, and I just remember thinking, "Oh, I completely forgot the tune came on," and I was like, "Oh no, yeah!" I completely forgot, and his zoo flew off, man. And his missus kind of pulled him back. It's like, "Yo, you're building a zoo on his back."
The kid is enjoying it. Yeah, exactly.
And he's enjoying the food. Exact words were, "Let him jam."
Damn,
like, yo. My missus had a big fat ass. She was amazing. But I was like, thank you so much. I was thinking that to it. But the tune came on and then he let me shuck out. He goes, I'm going to let you shuck out to this tune, both, yeah? But afterwards, I'm using you as a table next time. So as soon as the tune finished, yeah, I just assumed the position.
Jokes.
And my boy Rami kind of standing there like, what the fuck, should I just stand here next to him? I was like, we were just two little 15 year olds on our journey.
Usually, like, if you're the table for someone billing up, you just got to put your hands up like that and they bill it.
Yeah, but this was like a show of authority, innit? It's like, white boy,
exactly,
your table, you know what I mean? I was like,
on your back.
I really remember there was a lot less white people at that gig than there was at the Onyx and Cypress Hill gig, man.
Yeah.
I thought there'd be loads of diversity at the Foodies, but back then there was not much diversity in these kind of like hip hop gigs.
Mm.
But yeah, I remember thinking Onyx is going to attract the worst crowd, but the Foodies crowd, because the album was so popular.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Real heads got tickets and it was like, yo.
But Cypress Hill as well, they were huge, you know what I mean? And they crossed
and all
over.
That hits from the bomb. There was a lot of skateboarding stuff involved and all that kind of scene. They got involved in that.
They crossed over more than anyone. Yeah, man, they killed it. damn, I can't believe you got used as a table, bro. That's fucked up. I never even thought to do that to anyone, but
I spilled his zoo, man, because I'm like, oh, yeah. Oh, I love this bit, you know what I mean? Gosh, and his missus, like, she pulled him back. He was a big man, she pulled him back.
That's jokes, man. All right, okay, I'm going to take it back to the 90s as well. This is a tune. I don't know. I was just scrolling through my tunes and I found this one. I was like, oh, this is a cool one. You know Devin the Dude, who appeared on, he was on the Dre Chronic album 2001, and he's done tunes with a bunch of people. He like raps and sings and he's just a stoner guy.
There's a crazy voice.
With a bit of a weird voice.
Yeah.
But when he was a kid, he was in a group called the Odd Squad. And one of the rappers in the Odd Squad, I cannot remember his name, but he was blind, completely blind. And they did a tune called I Can't See It. Yeah.
Oh, shit.
So, yeah, the blind rapper. I can't remember his name. I'm going to look it up now. But yeah, so this is the Odd Squad. I can't see. It's just a classic 90s. It wasn't, didn't blow up. It's not a very popular song, but it's got that 90s typical down, sound. Check it out. You know, if you could only hear what I'm, you know, straight away with them.
It's kind of early 90s.
Yeah, early 90s. Let me look up this blind rapper. I like the chanty choruses. I can't see y'all.
If I hear a chorus like that, I think about you. It's like this, y'all. It's like that, y'all. It's like that, y'all. I always think of you on those kind of things.
You don't stop. Yeah.
This is that early 90s. This is like that Deluxe Mob kind of.
Yeah. So the members are Devin the Dude, Jug Mug, and Rob Quest. There's a video for this song as well on YouTube. Check it out.
I can't see a job.
All right.
It's kind of like Naughty by Nature.
Yeah.
Gorillas in the Mist, kind of.
Yeah, definitely, yeah, Naughty by Nature vibes for sure.
Yeah, man.
I love that track, man. And yeah, blind rapper, you know what I mean? There's not many of them floating about.
Yeah, have a look at the blind rapper, the battle rapper. Have you seen
Blind
him?
Fury. Blind Fury.
He's pretty sick, man.
He's sick. He is amazing. And his freestyles, he does freestyles.
That's
like
what I'm saying. Against so people. Cool. He takes what they've said and he like twists it around. He's properly logged in.
And there was another battle rapper, blind guy. I think he was from Australia. I can't remember his name though. But he battled a bunch of people. He battled the Immaculate as well. He was pretty good. He was all right.
He's like, yeah,
Blind
mate.
Fury. Yeah.
Blind Fury would fucking smoke him, mate.
Yeah.
Smoking.
Yeah, yeah, no doubt, man. All right, okay, let's move on to your last one. I think this is a classic, personally, from a classic album.
This is one of the greatest songs of all time.
Yeah.
In hip-hop, for sure, man. For me, it's, man.
That whole album.
Fuck.
What's it called again? Fuck's sakes.
You know what happens as well with this, with the chief rapper from The Roots, Black Thought. Yeah? Everyone's like, yo, who's your top five? Who are your Nas, Jay-Z, Rakim? People often forget to say Black Thought because, Black Thought is one of the best rappers to ever do it. Ever.
No doubt. I mean, he's starting only in the last few years. People are starting to really, really recognize that. I mean, yeah, you're right. No one ever.
Yeah,
put
because
him
of some freestyle that he did, like, you know, in the last like five years or something.
Funk Flex freestyle.
He wrote all this shit way before that. You know what I mean?
Like, yeah. The thing is, like, The Roots as a collective, he, like, you know, they never really had a front man. If it was, it would have been Questlove, the drummer, you know what I mean? The band leader. But
yeah,
he never got his just desserts, but he never did a whack verse, man. And Black Thought, he has an album out now. Him and Danger Mouse, the producer, Danger Mouse. It just came out a couple of days ago, man. Same time
I
as the Kendrick.
I need to check it, but I just doubt it's as good as this. This is called from Things Fall Apart, isn't it?
Things Fall Apart. One of my favorite albums.
If you're
into
hip hop and he's telling you, man, like, oh, the stuff I've gone through with the not being able to see like my own family and some of the things he says in this tune, you know, hip hop, you're the love of my life, and that's true. If it wasn't for you, the things I had to do, and you're like, oh, we used to hit up every corner store wall for you. You're like, oh my days, this guy's talking my language, man.
Yeah, but I've listened to a few podcasts with Black Thought. He's got a mad history, man. Like his dad was like a big time gangster.
Yeah,
he got shot, ended up getting shot or something. Yeah. And don't quote me on this, but I remember hearing and like his mom was a drug addict and shit. And like, you know, he had a real rough fucking upbringing, yo. And he channeled it all into this culture that we all love. You know what I mean? Which is, you can't take nothing away from the man. Let's listen to it. Act Two by The Roots.
You are the love of my life.
Yeah. This album was on repeat, man. Just round and round. Not a bad song on the album. This one and Common, Like Water for Chocolate.
This one and the other,
the same
the...
time.
Illidale Half-Life as well, man.
And also Black Thought as an instrument in the band, his voice, he uses it.
About to take you to the top. Every time something bad happens in your life and you hear him saying, hip hop, you're the love of my life, and that's true. I didn't know who the roots were from Adam. Yeah, I was into hip hop, but it was kind of like Ice-T, Snoop Dogg, you know what I mean? Like big names who'd made it to the UK. Yeah. Probably courtesy of you. And then I went to America, went to Florida. My dad had rented a fat, like, what's those cars? A Cadillac. Like, he didn't rent it. He rented some other car. We go, oh, I'm sorry, John, but the car you got is gone. So we're going to give you this Cadillac. I gave him this fat white Cadillac. I remember my dad like, yo, they're giving us a Cadillac. Like, sick. Fuck me. We're driving.
Was it a roof?
To Florida,
have the roof
Keys.
No. Did the roof come back? No. Okay.
No. We're quite lucky. We going to Florida, yeah? And it wasn't like Orlando and shit. It was like Florida Keys, yeah? And he stopped in some car park and he had to go to the shop. He goes to the shop and there's these two dudes. And I'm in the car. My little brother must have been like two. We're in the car. Well, he must have been, you know, I must have been about 12, 13, yeah? Mm. And it's just me and my mum and my little brother in the car. And we're in this car park. There's no cars. And there's just two dudes there. And I remember it was proper like Menace to Society. The guy had on no top, yeah? One had a vest, but this guy had on no top. And he had like a big silver chain, yeah? And on the silver chain was clipped on his see-through Motorola pager, bruv. Like just clipped on like that. And he was kind of clocking it. And he bowled over to the car. And I'm thinking, oh, shit. Like we're in the shit now. You know what I mean? It's just my mum and me. I remember my mum saying, like, oh, shit, you know, this guy's, like, really... Because there's no one there, you know what I mean? Yeah. He's beelining towards us. And he comes over, and he's, like, knocking on the window and shit. And I'm like, oh, shit. And he's knocking on my window, but it's like, you know what I mean? He can't see in, I don't think. And my mum's like, don't touch it, don't touch it. And I wind down the window, because I want to be cool. I'm like, yo, what's up?
And you should have wound it down. You should have wound it down going, yo, we got a problem here?
We
got a problem here?
And as soon as I said, yo, what's up or whatever, he's like, oh, shit, where are you from?
Yeah.
And I said, I'm from England. He's like, ah, he changes everything. He's like, oh, shit, you know, this little dude. He's shouting to his friend, little dude. He's like, what music are you into? And I'm like, because I was kind of into Metallica as well. But I was like, oh, hip-hop, innit, hip-hop.
Yeah.
And he's like, yo, go in that store.
Mm.
And I'm like, what the fuck? My mom's like, don't get out of the car.
I thought he was going to say, can you bend over? I need to build a zoo on you, man. You'd have been like... All right, really.
Or give me the keys. That's what I think he was going to say. Yeah.
All right.
But then he saw it was just my mom and, you know, like this bod-free family. He's like, yo, go in that store and get yourself something and take it back to England and tell your friends. And that's what he said. That's what he said. I never saw him again. I was like, okay, just go out. I thought I was going to get like fucking shot when I got out of the car. I got out of the car and he's like, go on, man. I was like, all right, cool. And I went into this store and it was like a music store from back in the days, but in America.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Fucking huge.
Yeah, they don't fuck about out there.
And I went to the hip hop section not knowing what. I already had like Doggy Style. I already had that Ice Cube with like the cool illustration, the Ice Tea with the cool illustration on the front.
You probably had the Chronic as well, the first Chronic.
Yeah, I had the Chronic. And I had...
you had Cypress Hill, Black Sunday.
I had something. I had Public Enemy.
Yeah.
Because my uncle got it for me. Anyway, I'm like, yo, shit, what the fuck am I going to buy? And I know I don't have long because my dad's going to come back. So I'm like, oh, man. And just the Roots. Yeah, just the Roots. It like looked like the word kind of looked good. You know what I mean? The Roots. Like it's the Roots of hip hop. Where's the root? And I picked up that album and I picked up Illadelph Half-Life. Yeah. And I had a Walkman in the back of the Cadillac. Went back.
On a CD or on a tape?
Tape. Both on cassette.
Yeah.
And I got back and I was listening to it, like, you know, I mean, and we're driving like through the Keys, you know, it's like this mad. This is back in the 90s when there wasn't much development. It was just like pure, just blue sky, blue sea, you know what I mean? Alligators and shit. It wasn't anything like Philly, but it was, for me, it was like, yo. And I remember like within 20 minutes, like taking my headphones off and then, Dad, you have to listen to this shit. That you have, this isn't that kind of Snoop Dogg. He hated the Snoop Dogg shit. I was like, you have to listen to this shit. Please play this in the car. Please. Yeah. And it was the Roots. And that was, you know, such a massively strong memory for me. And when every time I hear their music, I don't think of Philly and New York. I think of that time, that guy with his pager clipped to his chain around his neck. Him telling me to go in there. And just by, imagine all of the tunes that were in that store. You know how many tunes in that store, man? And I picked those two. And for some reason, I picked two albums of the same artist as well. You know, I don't know why. I just took something and went and paid for it.
Yeah.
And fuck me, best decision of my life, man. And I remember like even my dad going, yo, you know, this is quite musical, man. We listened to it like driving in this Cadillac through the Cadillac. Oh my days, this is it. Hip hop is the love of my life. I used to hit up every corner store wall. We were probably doing graph. I was probably writing something gash like help or something back then, you know what I mean? Like generic tag.
And that's proper good driving music as well, man. Those Roots albums.
That opened my eyes to like, yo, hip hop was gangster. It was like the Chronic. It was Snoop Dogg. It was like fucking bitches in the ass.
So
and then it was like, oh, yo,
Like,
who's this?
Yeah, this I'd say the Roots definitely. They were part of that for me as well. Yeah, because I was super in. You know, I got taken by that whole gangster rap thing. You know, early on, man, N.W.A. and fucking, it was all gangster hardcore shit.
Yeah,
but yeah, it's definitely the Roots and like Pharoah Munch and Cool Keith and a few other heads that kind of like, they're like, oh no, you can rap about literally anything, you know what I mean? And expanded my mind more, you know, which is that was dope, man. Yeah, I mean, yo, the Roots, salute, Black Thought, Super Don,
Quest Love, everybody, man.
Yeah really ill, and they're still going from strength to strength as well, man.
Now you turn on, you know, you're watching some fucking commercial TV show and Questlove is in the back playing drums on a live kit. You're like, what the fuck?
Yeah, what's that show? Sick. It's that guy, that really annoying fucking host, that guy. What's his
name? Or the English guy.
No, it's not. He's not on the Corden
show. He's on bare different shows, I think.
No, he's on this one, the main one, the Tonight Show with fucking, what's his name? He took over
Jimmy,
from Jay Leno,
Jimmy
I guess. Jimmy something. Yeah, Jimmy, not Jimmy Carr, Jimmy Kimmel. No, not Jimmy Kimmel.
No?
The other one. Fuck knows. But anyway, he's an annoying prick. I don't like that guy.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
The Roots, he killed it having the Roots on this show, man. Yeah, big up them, man. All right, let me play the last tune and then we'll wrap this up, man. Hold on one sec. There we go. All right. All right, my last track is a bit of a left curve, man. It's it's a group called Jazztronic. It's a Japanese group.
Okay, man.
Yeah, and it's this guy, I'm looking it up now, Ryota Nozaki. He's a producer and a DJ and a pianist. He plays the piano. He's ill on the keys. And there's this type of music that came out of West London, where we're from, where we are at right now. There was a genre of music called broken beat that came out of here in the early 2000s, man. Like Bugs in the Attic and a couple of other heads were on it at the time. Four Hero. It's like kind of It's like swung out break beats and sped up, but it's not quite drum and bass, but it's not like, it's not 4/4 house thing. It's like this like jazzy kind of break beat kind of broken beat is called, yeah. And anyway, Jazztronic, he took that genre and ran with it, playing piano. This is a song of his called Samurai. It's a really beautiful song. Check it out. So it's kind of dancey, but when the keys, when the pianos come in, and it, the way it progresses, the whole song is deep, man.
Well, it's all done by one guy.
Here it says it's a band, a music group. By Ryota Nozaki. I think he's just the main guy. But yeah, I guess there are other people in it. I don't know much about him, but I love this song.
Oh, I know this song.
Yeah? It was big for a while.
Yeah. Turning this up.
I'll wait till the keys come in properly when it drops a little bit.
I know this from radio. Yo, what's it called? I need to write it down.
Yeah, Samurai by Jazztronic. I've got a feel-good song for me, man. I put it on, I can dance to it, just like, just get lost in the piano, man.
It does remind me of, like, West London. Nighttime graph in West London.
Yeah. There's that really famous breakbeat tune. It was a Bugs in the Attic remix. What was it? Hold it down, hold it down, hold it down. It's an ill tune.
You know what this reminds me of? I don't know why. It reminds me of that street, that really long street in kind of North Acton where you used to have warehouse parties.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? And there was that one cash point, really like warehousey, really commercial, the one cash point on there, really long. Everyone used to get the Ubers there or the taxis there.
Yeah.
It just reminds me of that street, doing graph on that street in the nighttime, that street bombing. Wap, wap.
Yeah, it's an energetic track. So, yeah, it'll be good to listen to while bombing, man, for sure. But yeah, that's my track. You know, I just thought I'd introduce
that. Yeah, that's a nice track, man.
People.
That's a good, good track. I was going to be bringing some Jimi Hendrix tracks, some folk music on. I was just watching Ozark.
Mm.
Man, I don't know if you watched Ozark. There's some wicked tracks on that, man. I've heard
about the episode with Illmatic, where the character's listening to Illmatic. I heard about
Ruth,
it.
When Ruth, she goes to cap someone's ass. Mm. She's listening to Illmatic. It's actually like a couple of episodes after that, yo. This guy's playing, they're like white trash. They're playing in like their trailer park. He's playing guitar and he's singing. And it's like, it's a ghost of her dad or her uncle or something. And I had to stop the tune, stop the show to say, yo, this isn't this guy just singing in the show. Like this, he's doing a version of A-Tunes. Like, one of them ones, and I had to type the lyrics in, like pause it, play it, get more lyrics, type it in. And it came up as like some quite famous tunes. And I was like, yo, this is sick.
I've heard good things about Ozark. So it's Ozark. So you recommend it, yeah?
Bruv.
What's it about? I have no idea.
Bruv.
I know nothing about it.
It's about a guy who's a money launderer, yeah?
Yeah,
and he fucks up, and he gets his whole family involved, his wife and his kids. His kids are like 13 and 17 or something.
Where's it
and
set?
They get fully in the Ozarks, which What's is that? In the United States, like an area.
Coast, East Coast?
No, like Southern or Central Southern.
Okay,
something like that. Mm. He starts working for the Mexican cartel.
Yeah,
and he's the chief money launderer for them. But his like wife and son are like getting involved and shit. You know what I mean? It's sick.
The Ozark Mountains, northern Arkansas and southern Missouri.
Kind of has a Missouri vibe to it.
Okay.
But the acting, the scenery, the setting is, man.
And it's set in modern day. Or is it?
Yeah.
Is it
I'm disappointed. I've just finished it, man.
Oh, wow. Okay. I'm sure they'll do more.
No, that's it. They did more. This is like, that was years ago, like 4 or 5 years ago. They've only just released the last series.
And is it like end quite, I mean, don't spoil it for anyone, but does it end like it's real, like it's definitely the end of the show?
It's a hard, it's harsh life. It's harsh real life. That's how I would say it, man. It's nuts.
Yeah.
Nuts. You gotta see that. You've not seen that shit.
No.
Like, it's sick.
Yeah, I've still never seen Sopranos, man.
That's embarrassing. I mean, that's worth watching. I don't really watch TV. I don't have any TV channels. I don't have any Freeview. I don't have any Sky. I watch all of my boxing or UFC on what you told me, buff streams. You know, I just type in watch sport online. I've got Netflix. Yeah. That's it. That's it.
Yeah, to be honest, when you have the internet, you can literally access anything. If you have no morals against, like,
I went all in. I've got like a VPN and shit, like, so they can't. You know what I mean? I've got like watching everything. But Netflix is decent, man. I watch that shit.
Yeah. Yeah, my brother, he signs on. He's got Amazon Prime, he's got Netflix, he's got Disney Plus, he's got all of them. Thing, I'm like, why bother? You can just download that shit for free. But anyway, fair enough. You got support, I guess, to a certain degree.
I'm thinking of doing a bit on that. You know what I mean? Because before, he's like, yo, have you seen this show? You know, no, what channel is it on? It's on one of four channels.
Yeah,
and now it's like, no, it could be on one of like 30 Sky channels.
Oh man,
could be on Virgin, so could be on Sky, Disney, Amazon, Netflix. There's another one, a big one we're missing out. Like a big, big one. I don't even fucking...
There's loads. Yeah, there's loads of them out. Hulu, fucking a bunch of them, man. But like, I don't know. For me, morally, of course, I like to support when I can support or whatnot. But ultimately, because I collect records and I've been buying records since 1993, I've given these big companies, Universal, fucking, you know, Sony, and I've given them bare money in the past.
I've given you dough, man.
I've bought so much physical copies of stuff, you know what I mean, that I still have. So I don't know. I could imagine a youth now, you know. Yeah, you know, nothing would work if they all just streamed everything for free. You know what I mean? Of course, they need to support and do something. You know what I mean? But I don't know. For me, I'm done paying for shit now. I'm good. But, you know, I did have Netflix for a while, but then I was like, you just spend most of the time just looking through the thing going, what can I watch? You're just like scrolling and you spend half an hour doing that shit.
The good thing is if you don't watch much TV... Yeah. When you turn on Netflix, you're greeted with like four or five things. You're like, oh shit, I've heard people talking about that, and that. Like, Better Call Saul or whatever.
Yeah.
And you're like, I'm going to watch these. And then you don't watch it for months, turn it on, you're like, yo.
I tell you what, I watch a lot of YouTube, man. To be honest, there's a lot of YouTube creators. Obviously, there's a lot of shit out there as well, but there are some really cool YouTube channels that I check out. From time to time, I subscribe to them and that, and they release really premium content, man. It's not like stuff like Ozark, obviously. I'm not talking about dramatic things, but, you know, informative things and little documentaries people make about really niche subjects. And I don't know. I like geeking out and shit like that. Actually, one thing I'm obsessed with at the moment, I might have even told you, there's a channel called Jim Can't Swim, and it's basically an interrogation breakdown. So
I haven't heard about this.
Yeah, it's like in America and in England, but mainly in America, obviously they release the footage of the interrogation with the person. He might have murdered 15 people that morning, you know, and they get him into the thing, and then there's different techniques the police use to interrogate suspects. And this guy, he breaks down these different techniques, and we watch it, like the whole video, and he has little annotations and voiceover explaining how the police are working. And then he does examples of when the police fuck up. He does examples when the suspect is completely innocent, but the police think they're guilty. So you see the police like, and he also says the protocol, like if the police fuck up, then it later on, when they want to use it as evidence, they can't use it as evidence because they didn't read them the rights, or they were leading them on, or you know what I mean? Or they didn't provide them with water, or like, you know, they were like, what's the word? Intimidating the suspect. You know what I mean? All these things that can lead to later on, even though the guy definitely killed 15 kids that morning, they can't use that as evidence. And sometimes the guy can get off the case. Anyway, it's really fucking deep. Interesting. Jim Can't Swim. And now there are like a million copycats who copied this guy's channel. And there's some good ones and some really shit ones. But anyway, I've been going down those rabbit holes recently, man. I love those shows, man.
Something I watch with the kids, I need to tell you about on YouTube. See if it comes up on my YouTube. Nah, man. It's some Australian guy.
Yeah.
and he just like lives on his own out in islands, and then lives on like a floating tent in the middle of the sea, gets hit off his, like, you know what I mean, his paddleboard by a tiger shark, and fucking gets back on it and shit, just complete, puts his hand in like mad, like orifices in the ground and pulls out huge crabs. He's got like no tools, no nothing.
Yeah, dude, I think I've seen this guy.
He's a bit annoying. He's a bit like, oh yeah, fucking hell, I just fucking omelette, you know, proper, I know, like, Aussie.
There's one guy as well who goes around. Sick. There's one Aussie guy who goes around getting bitten by things. That every episode he finds another thing to bite him. Like he'll get like killer ants, and then he'll get a mad wasp, and then he'll find
he's
like
so
a
Australian otter. Man.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, this week, mate, we're gonna get fucking bit by a fucking shark, mate. You know what I mean? Film it, exactly. Mate, on the GoPro. Fuck exactly. Me.
I can't remember his name, but he's funny as fuck.
Fucking hell, man.
And but there's loads of like food channels where they don't just sit in their kitchen cooking, they go to crazy exotic places, like to tribes that's in the middle so of Africa, true. Or they go to like some Indonesian fucking family in the middle of bumfuck nowhere, or this mad war zone, and they'll eat like the traditional food there. It's really, really cool. But yo, man, that's us, I think, man.
That's it, man.
Yeah, brother, that's been another one.
I'm off to go and have an unexpected blowjob, man.
Yeah, boy. And yeah, man, and we'll be back soon, man. So tune in to Arms House, to your mum's house.
To your mum's house. Do you think I need to go and paint that yellow BR, bruv?